Hello, and welcome back to Choir with Knut. In today's episode, we're going to be looking at counterpoint. And counterpoint is kind of a loaded subject. It's considered to be like quite difficult. And if you've gone to like a conservatoire, you might have had to write a fugue. And it's kind of, that's known as something that's like quite difficult to do. For some reason, I've never really found it that tricky. And I think it's because I kind of have a natural knack for figuring out how to make a counter melody work. So I thought it might be useful for me to share my tricks for writing a good counter melody. What I find really exciting about counter melodies is that if you write a counter melody really well, then it can become as important a part of the song as the melody and the lyrics. So if you think of a good song or a song that uses a really good counter melody, like Hit Me Baby One More Time by Britney Spears, then you might know what I'm talking about. Because we all remember the bit in the final chorus when she goes, I must confess that my loneliness. And that's an example of a really good counter melody. Some of you may be familiar with the counter melodies used in classical music, known as descants, which are the last verse of usually a Christmas carol, where the soprano starts singing a really, really high bit, and it's really quite exciting. So I think learning a little bit about writing counter melodies will help you a lot with making your arrangements interesting and effective. The idea of one melody complementing another is old and well documented in Western classical art music. The simplest and probably first use of counter melody is the canon, where the melody is started by someone, and someone else starts it a little later, leading to harmony between the two parts. The most famous canon is probably Frère Jacques, a French song which, as far as we know, originated in the 18th century, though its exact origins are unknown.
Frère Jacques, 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 sonne les matines, sonne les matines, sonne les matines, sonne les matines, din dun.
With the rise in popularity of polyphony in the 14th century onwards, the mechanics of good counterpoint started getting codified, and certain compositional styles from this period, like the fugue, were entirely based around a melody, or subject, and various countermelodies that support it and each other. The master of the fugue was undoubtedly Johann Sebastian Bach, and if you want to listen to some great fugues, The Well-Tempered Clavier and The Art of Fugue are considered some of the finest works in this style. While the heavy use of counterpoint started diminishing in popularity around the mid-18th century, being replaced by the simpler Gallant style, counterpoint remained important in music and is not unusual to hear in contemporary pop music. You can have a look at my video on backing vocals for some examples of counterpoint used in pop music. Now, don't worry, you don't have to be a master of counterpoint to be able to do effective counter melodies. It does help to know some of the guidelines for doing counterpoint, but, I mean, you're not expected to write fugal passages these days. If you're able to do even just one cool counter melody, then that's going to add a lot to the arrangement. And you very rarely find pop music that uses more than one counter melody. Let's use a well-known song to look at how to construct a good counter melody. Happy Birthday is a song that most of you will probably know. It goes like this.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you.
I recommend that you decide on your chord progression before you start writing any counter melodies. I'll get to why in a minute. We'll assume that we have to go for a very simple chord progression in this case. Maybe we're being accompanied by a bad piano player or something, so we can't be too daring in the harmony. There we go. Now, to help us hear how the counter melody will play against the melody in context, we can add a bass line on the root of the chords, using the same rhythm as the melody. strictly speaking, a bass line is another example of a counter melody, so don't be afraid to be creative with it if you can. But let's just assume that we have to keep it really simple in this case.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you.
So, what can we add here? We'll hide the bass line and just focus on these two staves. Let's start with a really bad counter melody, like this one.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you.
Why is this bad? Let's start with the first principle of good counter melody writing. A good counter melody is active when the main melody is static and vice versa. In this example, the counter melody is moving at the same time as the main melody, giving it no separate identity. So let's rewrite it following this principle and see what we get.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
Already we see that this works a little bit better than the first example. I mean, the first example was pretty much just an echo of the tune using the exact same notes. So even just by shifting it so that it happens in the space between the notes of the melody, you will already find that it works better as a counter melody. That being said, I mean, it's still kind of simple and it just kind of barely works. There's a few bits, there's a few points where it does clash a little bit with the melody. So let's look at how we can improve this further. We can further improve our counter melody by not letting it happen on the same pitches as the melody. Make it complement the melody harmonically. This is where having decided on the chord progression comes in handy, as you can use your knowledge of harmony to decide what notes are missing from the chord and add them in. Let's try this version.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
This is better, but still a little mechanical, as it just adds in harmony notes without considering how to play off the melody in a particularly musical way. The very best counter melodies have a bit more of an identity. That is, they could potentially be melodies in their own right. And this is where it can get a little tricky. Let's scrap our existing counter melody and apply the two principles we've used while trying to create more of a shape to our counter melody.
Happy birthday to
happy birthday to
happy
you.
Birthday to you.
Happy birthday,
happy birthday,
happy birthday to you.
You might be able to tell that this is a more effective use of a counter melody because it serves several purposes. It does harmonic work where it fills in the chord, singing on notes that the melody isn't on. It also uses different rhythms to the melody, doesn't take up too much space when the melody is active, it kind of fills in the gaps a bit. And that's kind of what you should aim for with a counter melody. Make it fill in the gaps so that when, if you imagine that the audience is like quite easily bored, they'll be like, oh, there's a long note. I'm bored now. I'm not going to listen. But then you have someone else coming in on that side doing something else. And they're like, oh, they stopped, but they're doing something. So I'm going to listen to them. And then when the melody comes back, they're like, oh, there's the melody that I know. Of course, the audience isn't going to be like that, but it's a good way to think of it when you're designing a counter melody. How do you keep the audience interested from start to finish? By filling in the gaps. Keep in mind that a counter melody will always be secondary to the melody. So don't try to be too fancy to the point where you draw the attention away from the main melody. Because the main melody is like the main actor and the counter melody is the supporting actor. You can be really clever with it, but always make sure that it supports the melody effectively. One thing that my examples don't really showcase here is that a really useful way to do counter melodies is to do them in different ranges. So say that your tenors are doing the melody. If you put a counter melody in the soprano range, that will kind of help people keep them separate in their ears, because they'll be like, okay, so that range is where the melody sits, and above here you have the counter melody. It's just another trick to keep them separate so that they don't overlap. If you're wondering how to best start constructing a counter melody, have a look at the melody itself and figure out what its principal features are. Is it mostly long notes performed smoothly? A counter melody that is more detached and uses shorter phrases will complement it well. Does it generally stay in a high range? Something lower in pitch will create some contrast. There are many options, and once you get into the habit of designing effective counter melodies, you may soon find yourself trying to put fugue-like passages into all sorts of music. Hey, as long as it works, why not? That's it for today's episode. I hope you found my tips useful and that maybe you've been inspired to try and write some counter melodies of your own. Let me know in the comments if you have any questions, and be sure to share this video with your friends if you think they'll find it useful. Also, keep subscribing to my channel. I'm really happy that I recently passed 350 subscribers. And God's be willing, when I look back at this video in a year from now, I'll be like, 350? Oh, that's so few. I have like 2 million now. Anyway, I'll see you in a few weeks for the next episode of Choir with Knut.